This show is part of the RetroZap.com podcast network.
This is Podcast Stardust.
This station is now the ultimate power in the universe.
With Dennis Keithley and Jay Krebs.
Your behavior is continually unexpected.
The galaxy source for Star Wars news, reviews, and discussion.
Now witness the firepower of this fully armed and operational battle station.
Hello, I'm Dennis Keithley.
And I'm Jay Krebs.
And welcome to another fully armed and operational edition of Podcast Stardust, the galaxy source for Star Wars news, reviews, and discussion. Before we get to this week's review of The Mandalorian, Jay, where can we be found around the internet?
We are on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Podcast Stardust, and we can be reached by email at podcaststardust@retrozap.com.
So this week we are getting into Chapter 5 of The Mandalorian, The Gunslinger, and as always, this is a full spoiler discussion. So we appreciate the download, but if you haven't seen it, you might want to step aside and then come back to this later and save it for a time until you have had an opportunity to watch it. But if you don't care, then hang out for the ride. Jay, with that, you want to get into the summary of this episode for us?
Sure. This one was written and directed by Dave Filoni. The episode begins with the Mandalorian and the child aboard the Razor Crest in a fierce dogfight with another bounty hunter. After a quick maneuver, the Mandalorian wins the battle, but the Razor Crest suffered significant damage. The nearest planet is Tatooine, and the Mandalorian lands at Mos Eisley Spaceport, where a mechanic, Pelimato, agrees to work on the ship while he finds work to fund repairs. In the famous Mos Eisley Cantina, the Mandalorian meets rookie bounty hunter Toro Calican, who is looking to make a name for himself by hunting down the notorious assassin Fennec Shand. The Mandalorian initially refuses, but agrees to help in exchange for the entire bounty. Toro just wants the fame. After negotiating with Tuskens for passage across the desert, they eventually catch up to Fennec and the trap she set for them that involved a dewback and a dead bounty hunter. They wait until nightfall and then eventually get the drop on Fennec. However, to bring her in, they need another ride, and the Mandalorian goes back for the dewback. He returns to find Fennec's body after Toro shot her once she filled him in on the value of the Mandalorian and the child. Back at the spaceport, the Mandalorian wins a showdown with Toro, shoots him, and then pays off Peli before departing the planet. The episode concludes with a mysterious figure approaching Fennec's body in the dark.
Yeah. So, as you mentioned off the top, this is the second episode directed by Dave Filoni, and it's the first episode that wasn't written by Jon Favreau, so that was kind of interesting. But, you know, 30 seconds or so, what was your overall impression of this one?
Well, definitely quite a diversion from the last ones that we've seen, and it's hard to believe that we're already into Chapter 5. I mean, yeah. I know we had two chapters the first week, but that means that we've had a month of The Mandalorian already, which is crazy to think about. You know, there was a lot of fan service in this particular episode. And as much as I've really loved it up until this point, and we've talked about, you know, all the throwbacks and everything else, I don't know. This one, there were just some things that I felt like they revisited, which was cool. But then again, it just kind of felt a little overdone to me. But I felt like the story itself was a very interesting one, with Toro kind of trying to get his feet wet, so to speak, in the whole line of the Mandalorian sort of, you know, way of life in terms of bounty hunting and whatnot, and that the fact that he did respect him, and yeah, kind of waiting to see what that mysterious end is going to be with that person that jingle jangles on the end.
Yeah,
there.
Definitely. As for me, I really enjoyed this episode. It's not my favorite of the series so far, but it's still really good. I really appreciated that Dave Filoni does what Dave Filoni always does, and he kind of turns convention on its head with some of the things that we saw in this episode. And we'll get into some of those things as we go along with our conversation. But it was an interesting episode. There's certainly a lot to talk about here.
Yes.
They did go back to Tatooine, which is our first legacy planet of the series, which is kind of cool to see because, for the most part, a lot of the new Star Wars content has shied away from going back to the places we know. You know, The Force Awakens, The Last Jedi, almost entirely new locales, and Rogue One had very little that we knew outside of like Yavin 4 and Mustafar, but even then, Mustafar wasn't that major a role in the thing, and it did revisit a whole lot of things that we'd previously seen. This, you know, Resistance has done a lot of brand new stuff as well, but, you know, so Tatooine is the legacy of all legacy worlds that right. we have in Star Wars. It's appeared more than any place else in the movies. Mm-hmm. You know, so let's just start there. You know, I was kind of impressed that when he landed there, he landed in Docking Bay 35, and that was Steve Bloom, by the way, that directed him to land there.
Oh,
so,
okay.
Star Wars veteran. Then he gets to the cantina, which is the famous Mos Eisley cantina from A New Hope. But that place has really evolved since we saw it last mm-hmm. in the chronology. What did you think about that?
Yeah, that was really neat to see the fact that there were droids actually serving, because as we know from the original trilogy and A New Hope, is that no droids were even allowed in there to begin with. So yeah, I mean, in that, and I don't want to sound negative when I say that there was a lot of fan service. It wasn't that that was a bad thing. I mean, you know, it does feel like home. As you said, it's the first legacy planet, and he flew right past the same crest that mm-hmm. Obi-Wan and Luke were looking over when Obi-Wan first told Luke about Mos Eisley. You will never find a more wretched hive of scum and villainy. You know, so that was kind of cool. And then to see Toro sitting in the exact same spot as Han, almost in the exact same pose while right. he was sitting there. You know, it is kind of cool that way. But yeah, it's definitely changed in a lot of ways. What was your feeling?
Very similar. It was a little less populated than mm-hmm. the cantina that appeared in A New Hope. It was not as dark and smoky as that cantina was. And of course, you mentioned the droids. There was an R5 tootling around, and there was some EV series. You know, the most famous EV droid that we know of is the one that worked in Jabba's palace and was torturing mm-hmm. other droids.
EV-99. Yeah.
Yeah, and so this one was sitting there serving drinks and telling the Mandalorian he was going to have a hard time finding work. And then there was that kind of a praying mantis creature over in the corner mm-hmm. that when they filmed A New Hope, they had a giant green praying mantis that was there on the set that didn't make the final cut of the movie. And so I couldn't help but wonder if that was some sort of an homage to that attempt to get that character into the movie. But that's the place that we meet Toro Calican. What did you think about him?
He just kind of gave me the creeps a little bit. I'm not going to lie. Mm-hmm. I wasn't a real super big fan of his character at first. He just didn't seem like he really fit the mold, which I guess maybe is the whole point of it, is that here, you know, he was trying to act all big and bad and, you know, kind of put himself out there as, oh, I've been in the guild long enough, but then comes clean and says, this is my first job, you know?
Right.
So, yeah. So he was definitely a different type of character than we've seen before. So yeah, I mean, that was just basically my first impression.
He very much fills a Western trope type of a character. And that is the young gun that is getting some mentorship from a veteran or an experienced type mm-hmm. of a gunfighter. Mm-hmm. And then by the end of the movie, the episode, whatever it is, he has a drawdown with that gunslinger and typically loses, where, you know, experience wins out in this case. And the younger protege doesn't take advantage or doesn't absorb all the wisdom that's been imparted on him. And this is seen later in the episode when they're trying to wait out Fennec Shand and waiting for nightfall. And the Mandalorian goes off to snooze by the speeder bikes. And, you know, Toro's there and he's like, oh, did you fall asleep, old man? And then he practices drawing against the Mandalorian. And so finally the Mandalorian pipes up, you know, are you done yet? And then, as opposed to just honoring the arrangement they made, which was to capture Fennec Shand, bring her in, he gets the fame, the Mandalorian gets the bounty, he decides that he can go for the bigger score by turning the Mandalorian and the child in. And, you know, that is his ultimate undoing. So it's very much that type of a character. Overall, I thought, you know, he filled that role very well, which was he had that arrogance about him. He seemed to be more attracted to the lifestyle mm-hmm. than he did the, which is kind of funny when you think about it. I've never thought of bounty hunters being glamorous, but he really kind of seemed to like that image. You know, he desperately wanted to get into the guild and be a bounty hunter. And he had a sizable amount of credits on him mm-hmm. at the end of the episode that the Mandalorian turned over to Pelimoto. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, the other big character in this episode was Fennec Shand. And I know both of us have been looking forward to Ming-Na Wen's appearance. What did you think about her?
Really, she didn't have as big of a role as I thought that she would in this particular episode. She's very mysterious, which was really cool. And you see her, you know, kind of pulling that part of her helmet down just so that she could see just enough. But for the legendary kind of image that we were built up to believe that she was this elite mercenary and everything like that, it was, in some ways, it was a little bit, you know, disappointing to see the demise come so quickly. And I know that we had kind of rolled around the idea of, oh, well, maybe she's, especially me, I'm like, oh, maybe, you know, stranger things have happened in Star Wars, especially. Maybe she's going to survive this. But mm-hmm. but I don't know. I mean, guess we'll have to see. But it's, you did say that, yeah, that IMDb or something like that had her listed as just one episode. So
right. Yeah. She's only got the credit for one episode on IMDb. Now, that can change. And it may be that they've decided not to reveal that she's got future involvement. And we know Jon Favreau was writing a second season of The Mandalorian, and that's in production right now. So maybe she shows up again. And I agree with you. As I love Ming-Na Wen. I love her as an actress. She's, you know, fantastic in Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. And, of course, you know, she's the voice of Mulan. Mm-hmm. And so I was a little disappointed that this is what we got.
Yeah.
You know, less than one full episode of the show. And so I'm hoping that they find a way to bring her back. She gave Toro all that he could handle in their mm-hmm. fight, and she was clever in setting up a trap with the Dewback for the Mandalorian. But yeah, you know, it was just kind of disappointing. I got to believe that she was clearly setting up Toro, that once she was uncuffed, she was going to take him out.
Mm-hmm.
And but he was smart enough to realize that, and you know, why split the bounty with her on the Mandalorian and the child when he could just take the whole thing for himself? But again, that was kind of some of Toro's inexperience shining through, that as soon as the Mandalorian came back and saw that her body was there, he was going to come up with a plan to take down Toro when he got back to the spaceport. Mm-hmm. But yeah, but I'm hoping that whoever that was that showed up at the end of the episode, and we'll talk about them in just a little bit, managed to save her and take her somewhere that she could recover and that she hadn't died already.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I was just, you know, as far as if this was her only episode that she was going to be in, then I really wish that they would have done more with her character. Mm-hmm. Because, I mean, if you think about, you know, with the last episode, the last chapter that we got with Cara Dune, and of course, we know we're going to see her again. However, we don't know if we're going to be able to see Ming-Na Wen's character again, Fennec Shand. So I guess, you know, as far as like the bang for your buck, I didn't feel like we got enough bang.
That's true. I don't disagree with that whatsoever. And then I guess we should spend a little time talking about Pelimoto. What did you think about her character?
She's adorable. She's just adorable. Yeah. I love the whole thing with the pit droids and the whole relationship that she had with them and just the interaction that she had with the Mandalorian. And just she wasn't taking any gruff. That's for mm-hmm. sure. And then when the child comes out and she realizes that it's actually a child and she was prepared to shoot it, and she just got all motherly and all matronly then. And she was very protective. And even told the Mandalorian at one point that you've got a lot to learn about raising him or raising yeah. the child. Although I didn't really like the fact that she kept calling the child it. You know, it was one of those things where maybe she didn't know if it was a boy or a girl, but she kept saying it instead of he or she. So that was
there's been a lot made of that, I think, throughout the course of this series. And I'm trying to put myself in the place of these characters, which is mm-hmm. they're in a galaxy where there's how many hundreds, if not thousands, of different races across the galaxy. Mm-hmm. And they probably all can't be divided into male and female.
This is true. Good point.
And so as rare a character as Yoda was, you know, prior to this child, the only examples, as we've talked about in the past, is Yoda and Yaddle. Mm-hmm. So it's not like there was a bunch of them around for, as far as we know, for her to know one way or the other about this. And unless she peeked under its little robe, you know, what would she do? So no, I get what you're saying there. And I'm just trying to be a little bit tolerant of the situation that is going on with the galaxy there. I liked her quite a bit. I like that she was a character that I suspect gets underestimated quite a bit because mm-hmm. she's just kind of folksy, maybe to say mm-hmm. is the description I want to use. But she didn't let the Mandalorian off the hook when he landed that ship and, you know, he told her that he had 500 credits. She's like, well, that might pay for you to dock here. Mm-hmm. But she gave him the benefit of the doubt because she knew he'd find work. And then, of course, when the baby showed up, then she was holding him accountable for, you can't just leave a child behind in your ship. What are you thinking? Mm-hmm. But at the same time, it became clear to her that the Mandalorian is just not there to hunt down a bounty, that the Mandalorian's got a better, higher purpose.
Definitely. definitely. And that was very savvy of her, for sure. And two things on that. I loved the scene with the pit droids and playing the sabacc. I just thought that was so adorable. And then talking about the Mandalorian leaving the child in the ship, that was such a tender moment when he was sleeping and then he just so gently laid him down. And he didn't just lay him down. He kind of like not really patted him, but just, you know, he sort of put his hand on him in a gesture of gentleness. And I just thought that that was a really sweet moment.
Yeah, because he has no clue really about how to be a father. He's protective and he's trying to be paternal. He just doesn't know how to do it. And so it's interesting watching him make this voyage. You know, frankly, I mean, I'm pretty certain I had a better idea how to be a dad when I became one. But it really helps when you have a partner to help you figure out that voyage. But I want to talk about the Tusken Raiders a little bit here. I loved their appearance in this episode. What did you think about them?
Yes, I thought this was super cool. And I was really impressed with the signing, using the sign language there. And I had seen something briefly that there was actually a deaf actor that was hired for that role. And so I don't know if that was American Sign Language that they were doing. I'm assuming that it probably was. But it just was really impressive to me that, I mean, obviously the Mandalorian's been around long enough. And, you know, he was sitting there like talking to them and signing with them. And Toro is saying, "What are you doing?" "I'm negotiating," you know. And they were so respectful of him at that point in just the way that he was conversing with them and basically treating them with respect.
Yeah. No, I really like that as well, because the previous presentation that we've had of the Tuskens in live action situations was in A New Hope, where they ambushed Luke and 3PO and just attacked them. Mm-hmm. And then in Attack of the Clones, when they kidnapped Shmi and essentially tortured her to the point of death. And Anakin showed up just in time to see her die. And then he slaughtered a whole bunch of them. And then, of course, we saw them in The Phantom Menace when they were hanging out on the racetrack, taking shots at the racers as they went by.
The pod racers, yeah.
The comics have been a bit kinder to the Tusken Raiders. But I really like the Mandalorian's point, which is that, you know, from their perspective, we're trespassing all over their land. You know, they're the locals. We're the trespassers. And so, yeah, I agree with you there. I really did like the idea that they were just not pure savagery, that they were they were a people that had their own customs, their own way of life, and they had a claim to this land that the Mandalorian respected and honored.
And even though it's Legends at this point as well, the Kenobi novel had some interactions with some of the Tuskens, and then I know with some of the other earlier Legends novels as well, with Tahiri Vela, she was actually raised by Tusken Raiders.
Right.
So this is kind of a nice, you know, draw in with some of those kinds of ideas too.
Yeah, definitely. So one of the things that kind of downgraded this episode all overall for me is that when you compare it to the first episode of the season, and I'm making that comparison because Dave Filoni directed them both, this one seemed a lot less cinematic to me. And the most obvious comparison that we learned, that planet that Greef Karga is on and that the client was on, is called Navarro. In the course of this episode, Fennec Shand lets that slip to Toro when she's talking about this. The Mandalorian ran off with the asset on Navarro and shot up the guild there. And that's why he's so valuable. But if you look at the frames from that episode, they're full of activity. When the Mandalorian walks from one end of the town to visit the client, and from the client to the convert where the Mandalorians are hanging out, there's stuff happening all over the place. It's full of things like, you know, Kowakian monkey lizards getting roasted on a spit, or droids in the corner, and people making deals, and Jawas here and there. Meanwhile, compared to what we saw of Mos Eisley in this episode, when he's walking down the street, there's a dozen people out, but you're seeing like six or seven blocks of the city. And comparatively, when you look at the second episode of the season with the Jawas and whatever planet that was, there was a lot of detail in the weathering and the erosion and everything else that happened on that planet. And I thought that Tatooine looked a lot less visually interesting compared to what we've seen of that planet in the past, whether it was in A New Hope or Return of the Jedi. or The Phantom Menace, or even the scenes in The Attack of the Clone, there just seemed to be a lot less to it than what I was used to seeing.
Yeah, I have to agree with you on that one. And I'm wondering if it's because of the fact that since it is a legacy planet, and perhaps maybe it's felt that the fans actually do know a little bit more about the planet itself, that maybe that was by design, you know, that wasn't as necessary to add as many details because a lot of fans already know what's there. However, you know, there's also a lot of people that are watching the show that aren't familiar with Tatooine. So right. Yeah, I definitely agree with you on that. There's a lot less cinematically going on. And we talked about that too, with even the last episode, that it felt less cinematic as well. So, you know, again, I think we had the bar raised so high for the first couple of episodes that now, you know, things are kind of pulling back in scale, and but we're noticing. So I'm not sure how to feel about that.
Yeah, and this is pure speculation on my part, but I know with a lot of series, they have a budget for a season, and we've heard about how these episodes had a $10 million per budget, or something astronomical for a television series for 30 minutes, which is a lot. But I just can't help but wonder if this episode had a smaller budget than some of the others by comparison, and that's why it just didn't quite have the oomph visually that some of the others did. You know, that being said, there were still a lot of cool things. We got to see Banthas, we got to see the Tuskens, we got to see the droids, and you know, the EV droids and the R5 droid that we talked about earlier, and the speeder bikes that showed up in Attack of the Clones when Anakin was out looking for his mother. Toro came up with a couple of those, and so yeah, there was things that were interesting in here, but it just felt like they didn't put as much on the screen as what they had done in the first couple episodes of the season. So
agreed. There's that one comment that Toro made though about the speeders that reminded me, he said this ain't Corellia.
Yeah,
so I just thought that was an interesting little thing that they threw in there too. All these little things, these little comments, and these yeah, they're great, because again, it is fan service in some ways, but it's also a lot of fun.
Yeah, you know, the thing about the fan service, which I've heard a lot, seen a lot about on social media, is that, you know, that's essentially giving the fans exactly what they want. And while there may have been some of that here, I do feel like this story kind of goes beyond the fan service label.
Sure.
We've got 3 episodes left where I'm assuming we're going to get our answers as to who it was that initially was trying to get this child, and whatever the material is that they want for the child, and for what purpose is going on. Then we'll get a resolution of what's going to happen with the Mandalorian and his relationship with the guild and those type of things. But he's on the run from the guild. He's got to find a place to hide. He's got to find a place to lay low. And he's tried that once in the prior episode and it didn't go well. And so now I don't know if Tatooine was where he was going by design, or it was out of necessity after he got attacked by another bounty hunter. I kind of feel like it must have been by design, because why else would you be by Tatooine to get attacked by another bounty hunter? But
right.
Whatever the purpose is, if that's where he ended up and that's where they landed and that's where the next part of the adventure was. And so, yeah, maybe this didn't advance the overall story a whole lot, except for what showed up in the last scene. But that even kind of brings in this whole idea of Fennec Shand knowing so much about what was going on with the Mandalorian. Did you get maybe the idea that she may have been after the Mandalorian herself? Because she was going to meet a contact in Mos Espa. And then when she got left with Toro by herself, she knew everything about the Mandalorian and this child. And I'm just kind of wondering, for someone who's on the run like that, why would she have so much detail?
Right. Because, I mean, news can't travel that fast. I mean, the events of Navarro with the first couple of episodes, yeah, they may have been, what are we into, maybe a couple months in advance. But, I mean, still, if she was on the run, like you said, yeah, I tend to agree with you on that one. She had to have had a little bit more inside information, or maybe was even doing an inside job.
Right. So who do you think that was at the end of the episode that found her body?
Who do I think it was, or who do I hope it is?
Either and or.
Well, I like the idea of Cad Bane. I really do. Although I don't know if that's realistic or not. I know that there's been some speculation that it could possibly be Boba Fett as well, which definitely would not be a bad thing in my book. So either one of those would be pretty cool. How about you?
Oh, I'm thinking it's Giancarlo Esposito's character, Moff Gideon.
Okay.
I have stopped and watched that scene that last little bit several times, and it goes by so quickly. So you don't get a whole lot of opportunity to catch detail. If it's Boba Fett, it's a different costume for Boba Fett.
Right.
If it's Cad Bane, it's slightly different boots and a different type of a duster than what Cad Bane wore. I kind of feel like Cad Bane's fate is going to be addressed in this last set of episodes we're going to get coming up in the Clone Wars. Mm-hmm. And quite frankly, I don't expect him to survive that, simply based off of stuff that I saw at a prior celebration. But save that for another time. But while it would be cool to bring a legacy character in there, I really like that they've developed such an incredible story and an incredible series without relying on characters that we already know.
Sure.
And so while I'm not against, how do I say this? I wouldn't be against seeing a legacy type of character, but I would want it to be much more of a cameo type of appearance as opposed to a major impact type of appearance, mm-hmm. if that makes any sense.
Oh, it makes total sense. Yeah, I think you're absolutely right. And, you know, of course, as soon as we see that duster and those boots and the speculations start flying, and that is part of what the fun is, though, with the series, too, is just having people talking and, yeah. you know, talking to each other and with each other and having these debates. And, you know, I know we're doing a lot of that over on our Discord channel, and people are chiming in left and right. And it is a lot of fun. So I guess we'll just have to wait and see.
Mm-hmm. So is there anything else that stood out to you about this episode?
Actually, the very first scene with that bounty hunter, I loved that. I call it the Poe Dameron move that the Mandalorian took, where he almost put on the brakes and then reversed the Razor Crest to get, you know, behind him so that he could take him out. I just thought that was really awesome.
I've been calling that the Top Gun move.
When
Maverick slowed down and the enemy flew right on by. So,
yeah. That's my line. I can bring you in warm. I can bring you in cold.
I absolutely love that. Yeah. And as soon as that bounty hunter said that, you know, I could bring in war, I could bring in Cole's, like, oh, you did not mm-hmm. just steal his line. And so, exactly. And I was wondering how, if that really was a catchphrase that the Mandalorian was known for at that point, because we've only heard him say that line, what, once in the mm-hmm. first episode, mm-hmm. but then it came back and we all remembered it from then. Almost every single episode has had a line to take away from it. Like that, you know, there was that line, and then I have spoken from this the first episode. Mm-hmm. I have spoken came up again in the second episode. Then this is the way from episode 3, okay. Till our paths cross again from the prior episode. Mm-hmm. And I guess this one just didn't have its own unique catchphrase.
Maybe your name will be legendary.
But it's just not something that you can say in conversation as easily, I suppose, is the thing. Is I have spoken and this is the way. Mm-hmm. I've seen those two phrases come up over all social all the time. Anytime mm-hmm. the Mandalorian's brought up, someone chimes with one of those. So
sure. Yeah, that's a good point. Mm-hmm. Yeah, maybe the whole thing, that was a big noise for your big old ears, wasn't it? Or something.
Yeah. Her interaction with the child was just precious. So
oh yeah, always.
Because on the one hand, she wanted to profit from it, because she said to him, when the Mandalorian gets back, I'm going to charge him extra for looking after you. And then, you know, when he first comes back to the hangar and she had dozed off inside the booth, and he starts yelling, and she's like, I'm awake, I'm awake. It's like, we've all been there. You've dozed off looking after a kid, trying to get a kid to sleep. If you're a parent, that has happened. So,
oh yeah.
Well, anything else?
No, I think that'll do it for me.
Okay. Well, then what is your final thought and grade on this one?
Well, overall, it was definitely an enjoyable episode. I mean, I've been looking forward to these every single week, as I'm sure, you know, millions and millions of us have been. As far as the ranking goes for me, definitely not my favorite episode, for sure. But not my least favorite episode either. Well, maybe it is, actually. There was a lot of fun things in here, but I don't know that there was enough to really make me want to watch it 5 and 6 times and keep coming back to it like all the other ones have been for me. Because even the last episode, as much as I know there was some talk about how it wasn't as cinematic or maybe as exciting as some of the other ones, I still feel like that there was a lot of really great like moments in that episode. Mm-hmm. And not that this one didn't have them, it just didn't have as many for me. So as far as I'm concerned, I'm giving this one a C+.
Okay. I'm giving it a solid D, same as the last episode. I have watched all the episodes 4 times so far.
Good for you.
The first two, I've watched five, and I will get around to watching all of them at least five or six times. I really liked it. I like the way that Dave Filoni does turn convention on its head, and that we got an opportunity to see how Tatooine and Mos Eisley has evolved since the fall of the Empire. We got to see all those stormtrooper helmets on pikes at the beginning of the episode, which we saw in Navarro as well. But then we got to see how things have also evolved since Jabba the Hutt's no longer around. You know, the EV droid has mentioned that the Bounty Guild doesn't have a presence here any longer. And so it seems like it's a world that was trapped in lawlessness. They've begun to have some order evolve there. And without the Hutts, you know, communities like the farmers and things and the Tuscans are having their rights recognized going forward. And so that was a neat aspect of it to me. My biggest drawback on it was really just kind of the visuals and the lack of kind of detail that was added to this episode compared to, like, especially the first three episodes of the season. Those just had tons to see in every single frame. This one was just a little bit lacking there. And I feel like they did a great job trying to compensate for that, but you're on a desert world, and I understand there's a lot of sand, it's coarse, it's rough, it gets everywhere, whatever, but at some point they just could have made the terrain look a little bit more interesting as opposed to a big wide open field of sand. And with some dunes in it. So anyways, no, I enjoyed it. I guess it sounds a little bit more than you did, but that's okay. So that again will do it for our episode of covering chapter 5 of The Mandalorian, The Gunslinger. Thank you all very much for listening, as always. And I'd like to remind you that you can find all episodes of Podcast Stardust on Rush's app, Apple Podcasts, Stitcher, Overcast, and wherever it is that you listen to your podcasts. And of course, we are part of the Rush's app podcast network. And please subscribe to the network feed and get all the great Rush's app shows in one place. We'd love it if you would leave us an iTunes review. We've been getting several of those lately. They've been pouring out a pretty good clip, and we really do appreciate that. And if you are not so inclined, just word of mouth, sharing the shows on Twitter, Facebook, or wherever you talk to your friends on social media would also be appreciated. If you want to hear Jay and I talk more about The Mandalorian, we've both been guests on Coffee with Kenobi recently. Jay, you were on episode 308 talking about chapter 4, Sanctuary, with Dan. And then I am on this week's episode of Coffee with Kenobi that covers this episode of The Mandalorian. And we talk about some of these same topics and a few other things. And it's myself, Dan, and Jared Cantor on that one. Jay, one more time, where can we found around the internet and on social media?
And again, too, I want to thank everybody for staying with us and checking out our shows, because that really does mean a lot to us. And as Dennis said, those iTunes reviews keep pouring in, and we sure do appreciate that. So if you want to keep sharing and you want to keep telling people about us and where they can find us, you can find us on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Podcast Stardust. If you'd like to talk to Dennis directly over on Twitter, he is at DJKVER2, and I am at Joyce Krebs. You can also check us out on Pinterest. We've got tons of boards over there. We are also on YouTube, where all of our episodes, as well as our unboxing videos and some other fun things, are going to be over there as well. You can definitely email us at podcaststardust@retrozap.com. We always love to hear your thoughts, and we always welcome those. And you can go over to the Discord channel on the RetroZap server, as I was talking about earlier. We've been talking Mandalorian up and down and left and right and Rise of Skywalker and you name it. And our TeePublic store, we have tons of designs over there and lots of different products. And thanks to Corey Club for all those designs.
Definitely, definitely. Well, again, thanks for listening, everyone. And until next time, may the Force be with you.
Stopped into Mos Eisley to have a drink with Han at the Star Wars Cantina. The weirdest creatures you've ever seen at the Star Wars Cantina.